there's clearly a lot of interest in uranium as an asset. It's a huge, you know, systemically important asset for the world, and it's missing an electronic marketplace. So going into those areas, I think, is super interesting.
Imagine a blockchain built for you. No wallets, no keys, no hassle. Just innovation. Welcome to Xion, the first walletless layer one blockchain purpose-built for consumer adoption. With Xion, developers can build, launch, and scale products that are ready for the masses. No technical barriers for users, thanks to groundbreaking chain abstraction. All it takes to join the crypto revolution? An email. Say goodbye to complexity and hello to possibility. Ready to take the leap? Explore Xion today at xion.burnt.com.
We all want to believe in something. In Chinese, belief also means trust. We want to trust our systems and each other so we can build a future beyond what we know. Join us at Consensus Hong Kong, where belief becomes real.
Hello, and welcome to Markets Daily, hosted by me, Jen Sanasi. On this show, we navigate the currents shaping the crypto markets, providing insights into the broader financial landscape. So whether you're actively trading or simply fascinated by the volatility that is the crypto markets, this show is your compass to understanding what's happened, where we are, and where we're going. On today's show, we're joined by Tezos co-founder, Arthur Breitman. Arthur, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Of course. Now, I've said this probably the last like 20 shows we've had, but what an exciting time to be talking about the crypto markets. Talk to me about what you're watching today.
Oh, in terms of the market. So, you know, I'm not an avid market watcher. I think, you know, I wake up and I have a dashboard and I look at a bunch of like markets, you know, not just in crypto. I also, you know, I think equity markets and commodity markets are also very, very interesting. But, you know, I of course, you know, I look at the exchange rate between Tez and Bitcoin or USD. I also look at the exchange rate of the Bitcoin to USD. I like saying exchange rate instead of price. You know, price in some sense you're conceding something. Equity markets, broad commodities. But you know, I glance at it in the morning once, and then you know that's about it. I'm not an active trader in those market. I hold positions, but that's about it.
Okay, well, the reason we have you here talking about markets is because there is a new project on Tezos called uranium.io. This is a project that offers tokens backed by physical uranium oxide U308. Can you talk to us about what this is and what this means?
So that's a uranium oxide molecule, or also known as yellow cake. So, you know, if you're digging in the ground and trying to find uranium ore, most of the time it's going to be in this form.
Talk to me about uranium.io. What challenge does this solve for retail investors who were previously trying to gain access to the commodity?
I mean, I would say retail investors, but honestly, it's much broader than just retail investors. Mm-hmm. It's the only electronic marketplace today where you can buy spot physical uranium. And you know, that's the thing is these tokens, they're not, you know, they're not a fund, they're not anything like that. They actually represent direct beneficial ownership of uranium in storage with Cameco. So that's unique. It's not something that's available. Like if you wanted to have exposure to uranium as an asset class, your options were quite limited before that. You could go and buy a trust like the Sprott ETF, but it's a fund and it's not directly linked to the uranium market. So you're dependent on the fund manager to actually do the creation and redemptions. And so as a result, for a long time, it doesn't necessarily track the market. You have uranium stocks, but if you wanted a pure play and like directly own physical uranium, that's pretty much, it's either that or do $4 million worth of OTC trade with other market participants. So it's really unique. And it's really interesting that we're seeing, you know, I would say blockchains used finally for this thing that they were touted out as being great for, which is opening new markets, globally accessible markets.
Talk to me about the significance of this, because I believe this is not the first time that a project has launched a tokenized uranium offering like this. What's different?
So there was a project before that, but what they had, it wasn't directly physical uranium. They were sort of backed by a forward sales contract from like one mining operation, and then it turned into some kind of NFT project. So this is very different. This is direct beneficial ownership of uranium oxide. And that's not something that's been done before. And as a result, you know, you have basically this direct link with the physical aspect is what was missing.
Now, take me right back to the basics. Talk to me about how how this is going to work for investors who are interested in participating. How's it going to work?
So very concretely, this token has been launched on Etherlink, which is a layer two solutions built on top of Tezos, but which is EVM compatible. So for people who come from EVM type of ecosystems, it will be a very familiar situation. You can go on uranium.io. There's a KYC check that's required. So it's an on-chain system. So the registry is being represented on-chain. However, for regulatory reasons, due to the nature of uranium, people have to pass some KYC checks. But once they've done that, they basically have access to an almost DeFi-like experience. It's not DeFi, but it is the same type of experience where they can interact with, you know, an on-chain contract that can let them trade or purchase this uranium token. And I think it's a really exciting asset and a very exciting moment. You know, we're seeing a surge of interest in nuclear power. There's also a surge of demand for energy, specifically with AI coming in as a huge consumer of energy. So we're seeing this at the same time. New nuclear power plants are being built. Old nuclear power plants are being put back into use, and it's also come from a generational shift in terms of attitudes towards uranium. With older generation, I think on the environmental movement being against nuclear, but now younger generation on the environmental movement being pro-nuclear because it is one of the energy sources that doesn't have carbon impact, while at the same time giving you a more reliable base load than you would get from renewables.
Talk to me about what this says, if anything, about Tezos's, strategy moving forward. Are we going to see more tokenized commodities come into the Tezos ecosystem?
Yeah, I'd be excited to do that. I think we want to see how well this uranium.io is going to play out. I think we want to learn lessons from it. It's a very, very compelling offer. We're going to know, how can we make it even better? Iterates, and then once we have those iterations nailed down, there's a lot more commodities. I think what was interesting is, we've seen people try to to tokenize other commodities before. People have done gold, people have done silver. The issue with that is there's so many ways you can own gold. It's accessible everywhere. You could buy an ETF, you could buy physical gold. It's just available everywhere. It's much more interesting to go after markets which have clear demand. Like, there's clearly a lot of interest in uranium as an asset. It's a huge, systemically important asset for the world, and it's missing an electronic marketplace. So going into those areas, I think, is super interesting. It's for Tezos, it's a real opportunity because it shows to the world, historically, it's been the blockchain doing things for real, doing decentralization for real, doing governance for real, focusing on meaningful applications and not empty hype. And that's a great demonstration of that.
Well, the way you describe it is, you're going to watch and see. It's an exciting experiment. Talk to me about the challenges that you think Tezos and the broader industry might face as tokenized commodities become more mainstream, become more commonplace.
I think, there's a lot of work that went into doing this. There's a lot of legal work that went into finding a framework that was, solid from a regulatory perspective, but also accessible for people, and finding this right balance and finding the right setup to do this took a few iteration. There's also, I would say, some perception challenge, because for a lot of people in the crypto space, they may be used to this type of solutions and, using the chain for making transactions, using wallets. People outside of the crypto space might not have this expertise. And I think it's a bit of a bridge asset, because the nice thing, again, with uranium is that it's an asset that can appeal to a lot of people who found cryptocurrencies appealing. It is technologically flavored, I would say, because it's an asset that powers technology. It has a lot of historically a lot of volatility, and I think that volatility is a feature that actually have attracted people in this space. It's an alternative asset. It's an asset that gives you the type of exposure that you initially wouldn't have. So in that respect, I find that much more exciting than tokenized index funds or tokenized money markets or any of that stuff. And it's solving a real problem. To go back to the challenges, I think we want to bring, we don't want these products to be only for people who are used to crypto products and who are used to this. We would like to bring many more people, everyone who's basically has an interest in uranium as an asset class, for this to be perhaps their first foray on a blockchain.
I think that many projects are trying to do that. You and I know that. How do you think about bringing folks who are not used to operating within the crypto ecosystem to this project and to participate in it?
Well, the point is that there are many ways to participate in this project. One is via uranium.io, but you can also purchase this on Archex, which is a centralized exchange. And I think more venues will be able to offer this product. And so that way you can create an experience that's accessible for a wider audience. And, I see a lot of projects claiming that they want to do this. I see a few projects doing it in practice.
You know, it's been, I guess, a while since Tezos has been in the headlines. Of course, this news launched probably about a week ago now. Talk to me a little bit about Tezos in 2025. What can we expect? Are you, and I say making a comeback because there was one time when we couldn't have a news day without hearing about something that was going on in the Tezos ecosystem. What does 2025 have in store for you?
Look, I think we're in an industry that's fueled by reflexivity. So when people talk about something, they talk about something more and more and more. For Tezos, there's been a long period of essentially focusing on a technology, modernizing technology. Tezos was the most advanced blockchain from a technical perspective when it launched in 2018. And then it lost that status. Like it had a lot of advantages, a lot of benefits. But overall, I would say there was a lot of technical innovation and it didn't, incorporate them soon enough. And that's, that has started changing since last year with the launch of the smart rollup systems on Tezos. Almost, now a year and a half ago, a demonstration of 1 million transactions per second across different rollups. So it's been a period of basically, I would say, focusing a lot on the core background work to make the chain into the most compelling technical offering possible. But at the same time, also working on some of the solutions. So I mentioned that Uranium had launched on Etherlink. Etherlink is, an example of this technical work that has happened. It's a layer two solution built on top of Tezos. It's compatible with the EVM world so that we can onboard everyone who's been using those EVM chains without them having to change their habits, them being like users or developers. But it also has this nice characteristics like, less than, under 1 second latency for transactions and, very, very fast confirmations. For all of that makes it a very, I would say it's a refresh offering for what Tezos has to offer to users and developers.
During that quiet time, many other new layer ones popped up. I think you have a lot more competition now than you maybe did when Tezos was first launched in 2018. How do you think about remaining competitive? And do you feel maybe a little bit behind as you've been figuring out the technical aspects in this quiet time?
No, I don't think there's that many more competitors, to be honest. There's a lot more... I think there's a lot more L1s, but there are very few people who are actually interested in doing something real. There are some, and those are the real competitors. But there's a lot of people who are here basically where, they'll raise money from some VCs, they'll have, they'll hold 90% of their token, then their game will be to sell their tokens, quickly over the next few years. These are not long-term competitors. So, in that respect, I think there's tough competition, but it's a small amount. It's a small number of chains, which I would say are really competing against like serious opportunities.
I mean, I guess what it sounds like you're saying is there will be some kind of consolidation amongst layer ones as we move into the future. How do you envision that? How do you see that unfolding?
It's tough because I would say in almost any other industry, you would see a ton of M&A because you have like network effects. A crowded environment. And so in this environment, it would be a perfect environment for M&A. However, it's very difficult to do meaningful M&A unless what you have is fundamentally extremely centralized. So I think we'll see some, and we have seen some, but they were like very new projects who like didn't have really much to go on, and they were mostly marketing exercises. So I don't know if we'll see that much of that. But I think we'll see consolidation activity on a few chains. There's very little activity today on blockchain that is not, in some sense, subsidized.
You know, I've been asking almost all the guests who join this show throughout December this question, and I will ask you the same. We've been talking about tokenized commodities. But as you look towards 2025, what narrative do you think is going to drive this industry next year?
So that's very interesting. And first of all, I'm going to deplore the fact that the industry is driven by narrative. I think this industry should be driven by reality, not by narrative. However, I can answer that. And sadly, I think AI and AI agent is going to be a great narrative. And I think it's going to be, you know, a lot of shit, but it's definitely going to be a narrative. Like, people are going, because, you know, ultimately, I think a lot of people treat tokens as like a proxy way of getting some exposure to technology. And it doesn't really do that, but there's a lot of marketing, you know, wink, wink, saying that it does, even if it doesn't. So I think we'll see a little bit of the meme coin phenomenon. I think is going to, you know, it's not going to go away. It's been there for years, but I think it's going to bait a little bit. And people are going to try this type of, AI is going to be a big component. You know, at the end of the day, the thing is like, the best narrative to have is a narrative that's never going to be realized. So, you know, if you want to optimize your narrative, you should do like, we're going to use a blockchain for nuclear fusion. And then you can, you know, like not do anything for, you know, 10 years. And it's like, well, you know, fusion is coming any minute now. Or you could say like, you're going to use a, you know, like blockchain for quantum computing. And then you're fine for a long time. And people get excited about that because they feel like, oh, it's going to be the blockchain for quantum computing, the blockchain for longevity. In some sense, you know, like you want to do the blockchain for commodity trading. It's terrible because you actually have to succeed. You actually have to do this thing. Otherwise, people are going to say, well, that didn't work. Look, but if it works, then of course, that's a lot stronger than just telling people that, you know, maybe someday something is going to happen. So, yeah. That's the sad reality of our industry.
Is Tezos going to be the blockchain for commodities trading?
I hope so. I think that's a real use case. I think that's a very meaningful thing. We are lacking electronic markets for spot trading in the world right now, and that's something that can be done.
Arthur, thank you so much for joining Markets Daily today. It was a pleasure, and I wish you the best December month.
Thank you. Likewise.
And thank you to our audience for listening to Markets Daily. If you enjoy listening to this podcast, subscribe to the CoinDesk Podcast Network that is available on all podcast platforms. If you prefer watching the show, we are on YouTube. We're on CoinDesk.com. Subscribe, give us a thumbs up, and we'll see you tomorrow.